We're pleased to have Iva Davies here with us. Iva is to be inducted into the Australian Songwriters Hall of Fame this evening. Welcome, Iva.
Thank you.
I know in your career you've received many awards. How does it feel to receive one for your songwriting?
Wonderful, absolutely wonderful. I was a very reluctant songwriter, so it is quite extraordinary. it's sort of me writing songs is a bit like pulling teeth, really.
Oh, is it really?
It is.
Okay, well, you've done it very successfully.
Thank you.
When did you first start writing songs? What got you interested in that?
Well, I started off in an acoustic trio, and I kind of was the sort of spare wheel, really. These other two guys were great songwriters and prolific songwriters.
Yes.
And I just tagged along, kind of put in the odd harmony and whatever. I think that was from the time I started teaching myself how to play the guitar. So 13 by 14, I'd met these guys at a party and off we went and we played around the place and had no interest in writing songs. And I think by the time I'd got to the point many years later when the band started, I think I'd written three songs.
Okay.
Not a great start. Two of those, believe it or not, that ended up on singles that were, minor double J hits but didn't really do anything. So I wasn't very equipped for that first Flowers album, but that sort of really represents about the first 10 songs I ever wrote.
Right, okay. Yeah, I do remember that album.
And so it was interesting because we were preparing to record this album. A lot of the songs had been accumulated over the 3 years that we'd already been playing, and
yes. We
played a lot. We were a covers band, that's what we started as. And so I was sort of adding my feeble little songs in amongst these classic songs,
mm-hmm.
which was incredibly intimidating.
And
we got to the point where we had the producer lined up and he was thinking about it, and I wrote the most recent song, and it was a song, and he said, "Oh, great, that's the best of the lot. You know, we'll make that the first single." It was a song called "We Can Get Together."
Yes, I do.
And anyway, a few weeks went by, and we're just on the verge of going into record. And I wrote the most recent song at that time, which was a song called "Can't Help Myself." And he said, "Oh, that's even better than We Can Get Together. We'll make that the first single." So, I guess with practice,
yes.
I seem to be getting better. Because the most recent song that I'd written became the first single.
Okay. So in the early days, what was the reaction to your songs in amongst all those covers? Did people like them as much as the covers, or did the covers tend to dominate?
Well, it was a pretty tall order. We were up against songs by Bowie and the Sex Pistols and the Easy Beats, and we played a whole stack of Easy Beat songs. Songs by the Loved Ones, which I love, very early Australian band, and so they were classic songs, so it was fairly intimidating. I think we survived because a lot of the scene at that time was driven by people wanting to dance, and that was my analysis of it meant that we wrote a lot of hard and fast songs to keep the crowd moving. But there was a particular song that I wrote. We got a new synthesizer, and I wrote this particular song, and it didn't even originally have any guitars in it. It was just this sort of wall of synthesizers. It was quite a slow song, and I remember the first time that we played it was in a pub that we hadn't played in before. It was the Eastwood Hotel, and I thought, we're going to get murdered because you can't dance to this, and there's no loud guitars in it. There was no guitars at all at the beginning. It was actually the song Ice House, and of course the crowd stopped dancing, and I thought, this is it, we're going to get stuff thrown at us right now. But in fact they were kind of mesmerised. It was quite extraordinary, and I guess it sort of turned into this very early piece of goth, really, was what it was. But I thought at the time, this is an incredibly dangerous thing to do, to try and launch this on a punk audience.
Well, that's probably right. I do remember that song as well. I've got enough grey hair to remember all those. In terms of your catalogue, your backlog of songs, what's your favourite one?
Look, it varies a bit. There's certainly no doubt that Great Southern Land came into its own. Strangely enough, it had been forgotten to some degree until the Millennium Eve, and I was commissioned to turn it into a 25-minute extravaganza leading up to the Millennium Countdown, and it went out on television. We performed it on the forecourt of the Opera House to 4 billion people, and from that time on, people remembered it. And
yes.
It's had an extraordinary life.
It
so it's pretty hard to go past that song, I guess.
Yeah.
There are others I have a kind of personal soft spot for. The song Man of Colours I have.
That is one of my favourites.
A personal soft spot for, because it was unlike the process that normally happened with me in songwriting. It literally landed in my lap. It was as if it had existed in another universe. Mm. A pipeline opened and it just landed. And it was about, I guess, probably an hour in the making. And I remember sitting back in the chair and going, what just happened? Where did that come from?
Yeah. Who was the Man of Colours?
Well, look, a lot of my songs are amalgamations of a number of threads. And so there were a couple of sources. One was that I was flying back from America and there was a Time magazine given out for reading on the plane. And the cover story was an extraordinary story. At the time, America's most recognised and famous living painter, a fellow called Andrew Wyeth. And he was so famous that his agent and the galleries and whatever, they always knew what he was working on for a new exhibition or whatever. He lived on a farm with his wife in Pennsylvania and he had his studio there. And then he made this extraordinary announcement and he released something like, well, certainly over 100, something like 130 paintings that even his wife didn't know that he'd been painting. Mm. Painted over a period of 10 years, all of the same woman. Her name was Helga. And it's never been really resolved as to, you know, who Helga was in his life, but she was a muse.
Yes.
But the art world were in shock that these paintings existed, and I thought it was a fascinating story. And so I created my own story of an old artist, and at the time my mother, who was a very prominent artist, she was by then getting older and she was losing her sight. For an artist, of course, that's a terrible thing to not be able to see. But the other peculiar thing was that I'd been writing songs over a period of a very long time, probably three albums, about a young woman with whom I had a long relationship. And to this day, she has no idea I was writing songs about her. So it was the kind of secrecy of it all, I guess. And that was all those three threads came together in that particular story.
Great. Let's talk about screen music.
Right.
Now. I know you have written a bit and you've received awards for it as well. How different is it from writing popular music?
Well, for a start, the inherent difference is that you're writing music for somebody else. So you are not the most important person in the project. And it infuriates me, in fact, when often I see a television show and the composer is not even credited. And it's one of my private sort of beefs, really, that they don't even get the acknowledgement of what they've done.
Yes.
But, you know, for example, a project that I did, like Master and Commander of the Far Side of the World, was a very big budget Hollywood, A-list Hollywood movie. But I knew right from the beginning of that job, it was all going to be about what the director, Peter Weir, wanted. So it wasn't going to be about, you know, this is the bit of music that I think would be best for this scene. It's really having that discussion and having that liaison with the director as to what they're imagining, even if it's not necessarily, you know, your preference. That's the job. So it's quite different.
So when you come to write, do they give you a copy of the script, for example, and say, music here, music here, music here, or do you drive the process?
The standard procedure is that you do what is called a number of spotting sessions, they're called. And in our case, it was fairly standard. We'd go in with the director and the editor, and they would start at the beginning of the film, and they'd run the film along until spot where the director would say, and at this point, time code, make a note. And I had a dirty big list of things that I wrote out of that meeting. Wants the music to start here and he wants to go through this scene and wants to acknowledge this thing that happens in the scene and end at this point. And so you do that, and by the time you're getting out of those spotting sessions, you have a dirty big list.
Okay.
And that's basically it. You know, there are now 62 pieces of music or whatever it is of varying lengths, and that's where they go.
Yeah. Do you regard that as background music? I mean, in popular music, when you write a song, you've got a hook, you've got a chorus, you've got a series of verses, etc., etc. I mean, when it comes to screenwriting or screen music, do you regard that as background, or do you try to be as melodic as you can?
It depends entirely on the director, once again, and the director's preference. So, for example, Peter Weir uses music very sparingly, and he is very particular that the music doesn't lead the emotional content of the scene. So that's his thing. Somebody like Steven Spielberg, for example, demands that the music leads the emotion of the scene. So they can almost they are polar opposites. So really, if I was working for Steven Spielberg, he'd be wanting me to draw out that particular emotion as hard as I possibly could. Peter Weir, on the other hand, wants the script and the performance of the actors to do all of that stuff.
Yes.
The music just becomes support for it, but in a very subtle way.
Okay, yes.
So it's quite a different kind of approach. And I suppose you only get that if you're a screenwriter from years of experience. And I have, strangely enough, not a lot of experience. But I could at least appreciate straight up that this is really the director's vision. This movie is the director, and it's whatever they want. Even if I passionately disagree with it, my job is to give the director what they want.
Okay. And who approached you? Did you approach somebody and said, look, I'd like to do some screen music, or did somebody come to you and say, look, we've got this project we need you to work on?
We sort of retired from touring around about 1993, and then I did a number of projects, and they were kind of, one fell out of another, and this is a perfect example. David Bowie, when we toured with him, said to me, you'll never know who is listening. And so years later, in 2003, I got a phone call. I was sitting in my studio in Wild Beach, and very few people had the number of that studio. And I picked up the phone, and on the phone there was a voice, and the voice said, hello, Iva, this is Peter Weir, and I'm on location in Baja, and we're shooting a film called Master Commander, and I was listening the night of the millennium, and I heard your piece, The Ghost of Time, based on Great Southern Land, and I want you to get your team together and give me a score like that.
Wow.
And so it was extraordinary. It was a $190 million movie.
Yeah.
And I had to go to work in Hollywood to do the movie, and it was a proper A-list movie, and it was an extraordinary experience.
Yeah, well, you're absolutely right. You never know where the music goes.
Exactly right.
Never know. So what's coming up in your future then? Are you going to continue doing a bit of screen music, popular music?
Look, I probably won't be doing too much more screen music, but at the moment we're kind of in, I'm generally in either one or the other of performing or writing mode.
Yes.
And there's only been one occasion, I think, where I wrote a song on the road because I had to. And otherwise I keep those things quite distinct from each other. Right. At the moment we're in a performing block, and in fact last year we did about 35 shows, and we played to around about 300,000 people. Mm-hmm. So we've had a bit of a rest from that this year. We're doing a couple at the end of the year, and then next year we start up again in January and February.
Okay, so you still have the touring bug?
We have a fairly large operation and an extraordinary band and an extraordinary crew. When we started performing again, we were the first band invited to perform at Sound Relief. I don't know whether you remember that. It was in, I think, 2009. And from that time on, having gotten back together again, we sort of looked at each other and thought, oh, well, that was fun. We should do a bit more of that. So from that point on, I said to Larry, who was our tour manager and has been since 1986, believe it or not, and he's here tonight, still working with him. And I said, Larry, I want to work with the same key crew members every time we perform. So we're not just a band. We are actually an entire family. So our team, people like our front of house engineer, our monitor engineer, our lighting designer, are as much a part of the team as the members of the band and myself are. And so it's a great thing. And we all live in different cities, so of course we only actually get together when we perform. So it's great fun.
Okay, good on you. Well, thanks for talking to us today, Iva, and all the best for the future. And we look forward to hearing you guys tonight too. That should be a really great acoustic set.
Thank you very much.
Iva Davies.
I haven't toured for a year now since the first Simple Minds tour. Do you enjoy touring?
I'm going to enjoy this tour more for the break.
We Flowers with Walls.
I always had a fascination for music from when I was six or something. I can't remember. I remember actually the photos of me conducting when I was four. I mean, I can't remember anything about this, but there you go.
Anything, James Rain, and the band have just blown them completely away. Ice House, Iva, you must be very happy.
Yeah, I'm very happy. I'm very hot. It's freezing out here, but I'm boiling. I feel like I've just run a marathon.
What a sensational band, and what a sensational show. It's...
You've always really been a central figure in the band. Do you like to keep it that way?
I see myself as really the chairman of the board. And I think everybody regards me pretty much that way.
Mate, they're great decks.
You like that?
They're fantastic. Can we get a shot of his decks? Can we get a close-up of those?
These used to be a set of curtains.
Oh, they're very nice. And that... And those boots, they're good too, aren't they?
They were curtains too.
Fantastic.
Most classical musicians never even dream, or the thought never occurs to them that they should write anything. So I hadn't written anything at all. I never had any inclination to write anything. Not until Flowers was fairly well established as a cover band, and people were saying, "Well, you can't get any further doing this. Why don't you try writing some songs?" Mm. And the very first songs that I wrote, I remember the first song that I entirely wrote on my own, because I'd had a bit of help from one of the other members. With the first couple of songs. The first one I wrote on my own was Walls, and as you know, all of those first songs are on the first album. There were none thrown away. They're all the very first songs that I wrote. Everything that happened in that period amazed me. It amazed me that it got played on the radio the first time.
Kate Bush, and that was Wuthering Heights.
Yes.
And Lady Madonna by the Beatles.
Yes, 2 points out of 2.